So with that wonderful music to help us prepare for our time together, I invite us all to light our candles if you have one there. It's a lovely way to help us again center ourselves in this time together, a sacred time. And if you have a candle to hold up and you'd like to do so, it's a lovely outer sign, a symbolic sign of the light that is within us, the light that always shines, the light that never goes out, that is never dimmed, and is the truth of our being that we can always call on to uplift us, to hold us, to remind us, to help awaken us to all that we really are. So we'll put our candles down so that we're safe and can continue with our service. And we will move into our opening prayer, which is the Lord's Prayer. It's the King James Version. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So let's move into a quiet moment of prayer. Taking that energy of the Father that is an energy that we abide within, that is the wholeness of us, the truth of us, the divine in us expressing. Let's take a moment just to sink deeper into that awareness. As Jesus taught, the Father and I are one. And the kingdom of heaven is here now in our midst. There's nowhere to go except within to that deeper abiding presence. To know here that energy of the Father, and to know that the Father and I are one. And out of this knowing, let's take a moment of prayer to remember all those whom we hold in prayer, our own loved ones, and that greater world community in which we abide. And let us know for all of us, the Father and I are one. And so it is. Amen.
So our affirmation for today's daily word is, I bless all fathers with thoughts of gratitude. I am grateful for fathers, grandfathers, stepfathers, and all father figures who care for children and families. I pray they are called always to follow their guidance and to act to express divine love. I envision their hearts and minds opening to receive blessings of strength, patience, and tenderness. I see them supported in all they are called upon to do, and comforted during times of struggle. I pray also for children, young and old, as they remember their fathers. May cherished memories bring smiles and warmth, and may the love remain alive forever in hearts and minds. And for all those on a healing or forgiveness journey, I pray that divine love leads and comforts them on a path towards lasting peace. May the peace and love of God fill their hearts today and every day. And our Bible reading, the Lord bless you and keep you. Numbers 6:24.
Thank you, Aldika. It's a privilege to remember our fathers and all those that played fatherly roles in our lives and take that moment of silence. That's a blessing. Thank you. And now we hand over to Paul, whose title of his talk today is Like Father, Like Son. Thank you, Paul.
Good afternoon, everybody. Like father, like son. I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, that was almost used in an almost condescending way, wasn't it? Oh, look at him. You know, like father, like son. And I guess today we have to look at this in sort of in two ways, really. There's the spiritual aspect, which clearly we will talk about, and there's also the aspect of our own fathers, as today is Father's Day, generally refers to the people who were our physical fathers. Let's just start for a moment thinking about Jesus, our wayshare, and think about what he said. In Mark, the earliest gospel, he talks about Abba and Father in the same sentence. I think the jury is probably still out on what Abba actually means. Some say it means dad. Some say that there is no real basis for that. But if nothing else, it means a personalization of Father. It isn't just the Father. It's something to do with my Father. So Jesus felt this close affiliation, this oneness with what we call God. And I'd like to look at one other reading from the Bible, and rather than just reading out the three or four words of a quote, I kind of like to use the context so we understand where it comes from. And this comes from John 10. At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The words that I do, the works that I do in my Father's name, that I do in my Father's name, testify to me." It's interesting that, isn't it? He was immediately talking about it being in his Father's name, not him. So our first thing here about the Father in this. "But you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep." And interestingly, earlier in this chapter 10, he talks about, "I am the good shepherd. Just as the Father knows me, I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." So that's why he's referring to sheep, his followers. And he says, "My sheep hear my voice. I know them. They follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish." Wow. "No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." The Father and I are one. Well, an expression like father, like son, one can't go much further than that, really. I could almost stop my talk there. The Father and I are one. When I think back to my own father, my dad, he and I had a kind of a difficult relationship for the most part, because he was a very gentle, very kind man. Everyone who liked him loved him. But I was a bit of a hooligan when I was a kid. You know, I always wanted to do things my way. I always struggled against authority. And so he and I had a difficult relationship. The key times I remember when it seemed to work well were when we were doing things together. I remember when I was probably about, 6 years old, I had lots of Meccano. Every Christmas or birthday, they bought me the next bit of the kit to make my Meccano set bigger. And we built this wonderful crane thing. And it was supposed to be powered by a clockwork motor, but Dad went and found an electric motor. I was amazed, an electric motor that made this thing work. And later on, when I was a student, I wanted my own stereo system. I couldn't afford one. So he helped me build speakers. And that was when we really worked together. And I went on to have a career in engineering. And I think it was my dad helping me, letting me do those things that helped me generate the sort of practical skills I needed to go into my chosen profession. So now I'm actually very grateful to him. But what does father mean in our spiritual context? And I was going to say as teachers, but actually more than that, as just Unity's truth students. The place we typically go to find out what something means is to a book called Revealing Word, written by Charles Fillmore. And for the father, he says, the father is the living principle, the absolute. The living principle, the absolute. Just gives that idea of that purity. And the father principle, this living principle, he describes as the exact and immutable principle of being. Wow. Wow. That very essence of us. And Jesus talked about, and Charles talks about, his father's house. And you'll remember the quote about the father's house, depending which version you read, having many mansions or many rooms. And that was written in the context, again, from John, about going to prepare a place for us. But if we think about that, the father's house, that immutable principle, that consciousness, then the many rooms are the many states of consciousness we have, the different states of consciousness that we grow through as we grow through our lives. And the Oxford English Dictionary talks about the father as being the one who institutes or originates, I source. That's kind of the same thing. And it also talks about, this is a bit tautological really, but it talks about performs offices of paternal care. It's a bit of a wordy way of being dad. And actually, if we think that in a spiritual sense, then that paternal care is grace, isn't it? That's the paternal care that that God gives us. Also refers to a priest. Emily Cady, I'm talking about the father, and Emily Cady wrote Lessons in Truth in the 1890s, one of the foundational texts of Unity. And she says, at the great heart of humanity, there is a deep and awful homesickness that has never been and never can be satisfied with anything less than a clear, vivid consciousness of the indwelling presence of God, our Father. And she says that this personal conscious knowledge of the Father in us is the secret, the key to all power. Wow. She also describes God in a lot of the sort of the things that might constitute God as spirit, love, wisdom and intelligence, power, substance. This is powerful stuff, very powerful stuff. But I remember back. And when I was putting this talk together, suddenly sprang into my mind for no reason, a song I used to listen to. First of all, in my last couple of years at school, and then probably through most of university, a song that talks about the relationship between a father and a son. A lot of you may know it, Cat Stevens. And this, for those who haven't heard it, it starts out with Cat Stevens talking as the father, or singing as the father, then the son, then back to the father, then back to the son. And what I'd like you really to do is to listen to the words in this. Please listen to the words, and then we will come back and talk about it some more.
It's not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. once like you are now. And I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. Why, think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not. How can I try to explain? When I do, he turns away again. It's always been the same, same old story. From the moment I could talk, I was ordered to listen. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go away. I know I have to go.
Well, it's been a very powerful song for me, that one. When I first heard it, of course, it was about my relationship with my parents, about how I wanted to break free, how I wanted to do my own thing. But now it's different. I see it in a completely different way. And we all know that Cat Stevens was a very spiritual person. I don't know whether he based it on the prodigal son, but isn't it so similar to the prodigal son? The prodigal son had to go away and do his own thing. He had to try his own thing. And then when he came back, he was welcomed back into the fold. But he used his free will. And that is such a powerful thing. That's such a gift we're given, this freedom to choose to do what we want. But that song, like the first part of The Prodigal Son, is all about struggle. It's about struggle. When I was preparing this talk, I was going to go in a different direction from this point, but when I was meditating this morning, it suddenly struck me. This is what I'd like to refer back a little bit to my own relationship with my father. It suddenly struck me that what's important here isn't the father and the son. What's important is the relationship. And although I didn't realize it at the time, I controlled my relationship with my father, not my father. He wanted to do what was best for me, and he did do what was best for me, but I didn't let him in. I didn't let him be the father I would probably liked him to have been. And it said in the song there, you know, it's young, that's your fault. Now, I wouldn't want to say this as a fault, but it was me that produced that situation. It was my responsibility. It was my choice. I didn't know I was making that choice at the time, but it was my choice. And we bring that back to the spiritual situation, and God is always there. The Christ presence is always within us. You know, Jesus said, greater to his disciples, greater things shall you do. It's not God that controls the relationship. It's each one of us. It's me. I control my relationship with God. God is always trying to push the door open. It's me that's holding it closed. And that's really the point I'd like to make here this afternoon. We have the choice. I have the choice. I have the choice of my relationship with God. I can make it what I choose it to be. And as I go forward, I choose to try and let the door open and stop putting my foot against the door. I want that truth of like father, like son to be true in me. I am the image and likeness of God. Like father, like son is the truth in a spiritual sense. I am one. The Father and I are one. And what I'd like us to do is perhaps take that thought into a short period of meditation. and invite you either as we go into meditation — this isn't going to be a guided meditation, I'm simply going to lead you into a few minutes silence — but you can choose. You can either choose to meditate and contemplate the relationship with your own human father or father figure, or your relationship with God. But just contemplate for a moment the fact that that relationship, even if it's the relationship with your human father, is something that you can change in your consciousness even now through the power of forgiveness if you need to. So let's just take a few moments. Let's just become quiet, put down anything you're holding. Just relax, relax the body. Just for a few moments, contemplate your relationship with either your father figure or with God. And now, if you'd like to just start feeling the chair supporting you, become conscious of the room around you.
I just want to share a few words because it really touched me that you shared about your relationship with your father and how that has changed for you, and how you experience your father. And he's passed on now, he's no longer with us. He had a wonderful sense of humour, your dad, and was always making people laugh, and you've picked that up from him as well. So that's a kind of like father, like son. But what I want to honour and celebrate, and as Paul shared this afternoon, our relationships with our fathers can change. Some of us have had very loving relationships. Mine with my dad was a very close relationship. We saw things in a very similar way, and I've always been grateful for his wisdom and insight and understanding that really got me onto this path, this spiritual path, right from being a very young girl. But for many others, it's not the same. I have many around me that I know have had very difficult relationships and are still feeling the trauma of that pain and those relationships because of that real misunderstanding and the not coming together as the knowing of the love that we are. But just as you shared, Paul, how your relationship with your father now, you see in a different way, and you have those experiences that you recognize that he was in fact very much part of your onward life journey. So our relationships with our own fathers can change, and the more we can bring that relationship back to love and use forgiveness or healing or whatever, and that power of gratitude to empower that relationship. I believe that all our relationships thereby change as well, including our relationship with ourselves and our relationship with God. And I believe that all of life is about our relationships in all three of those aspects, the human aspect and the divine in us and the divine that is shining through. So our relationship with God also can change. And if many of us have struggled in that relationship with God as Father, that can change. As we change our relationships with our fathers, we also can and do change our relationship with God and what that means to us and how that lives and expresses through us. And the prodigal son is so much part and parcel of that story. And I don't know who doesn't love the story of the prodigal son. A lot of people say it's their favorite story in the Bible, because it really is that journey of forgiveness and that journey of coming home and realizing that as soon as we turn back, we are loved. We are never not loved. That love is constant and enduring. And it's such a powerful message. So whatever our relationship was with our fathers, it too can become even more loving and even more wholesome and an even better relationship. And if they've left the planet and they're no longer in form, that energy is still with us in our hearts, and that transformation can be a real blessing. So Paul, I'm sharing this really because it really touched me of what you shared, and we have some time this afternoon, and I wanted just to acknowledge that and to appreciate that in you and how that has changed for you, and to witness it for everyone here that might also be in a similar situation. So that's it. I think we can move to the closing part of our program now, which begins with the opportunity to share a love offering blessing with us, our ministry in all the shapes and forms that it takes, that survives by the orders that you have with Through Daily Word and the donations that you make. This is how we are able to do that. We do as much as we can without any cost, no charge. But if you can find a way to donate to support our work, then we warmly welcome and appreciate the donations. And you can do it again through the website. But just by showing up today, you are giving your time and your energy with all of us to the present. So let's take a moment to bless ourselves, perhaps with our hands on our heart centers here, just to acknowledge divine love as Father, that Father energy, divine love and wisdom flowing through us is the truth of us. As we read this affirmation together, divine love expressing through me and as me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, all that I receive, and my awareness of all that I am. And in this moment, close your eyes and draw in that awareness. Divine love is expressing and multiplying my awareness of all that I am. All that I am is becoming and being more beautiful, more aware, more light, more loving, more joyful in us. And as we get that sense of our awareness of who we are expanding and growing, we too can see that in those around us, including the Father figures that have been important to us in our lives. Okay, so let's just close with a simple thank you there as we move on to our peace song. And as we continue this theme of Father's Day, we have the version, the traditional version of the peace song in the traditional words as it was originally written. And this is sung by Alec Jones. So thank you.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be with God.
So peace begins with us, because as we say the words of the prayer for protection together, these words are reflecting through us and as us, so that we are the peace that we seek. So let's say the prayer for protection together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Amen. So thank you, everyone. I am going to invite you all to unmute if you would like to do so. Let me just find the right button to do that. There we are. And I'm going to go back to gallery view so I can see all you lovely people and say thank you so much for being here this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you very much.